Hey, Dwayne, it's Kevin. I just wanted to let you know that I was here and just finishing the setup, posting the video to a couple of Facebook groups before we get started.
All right, great. Thank you. Look forward to hearing.
All right, I think I got all my shares in. Good evening. I need to catch up with my all right. So far behind on my notifications for today, but it's okay. All right, Dwayne, let me know that if you can hear me, brother.
I can hear you.
Okay, perfect. All right, let me, all right, headsets is on. Make sure I'm plugged up right. All right, that's good. Now, where is my audio? All right. I'm gonna turn my music off. What am I doing? Headphone virtualization. Okay, suppression and left, right. You can do better. Okay. All right. I got to figure out the audio, but that's okay. I did something. All right. Let's go ahead and get started. We are live on Facebook, so I thank everybody for logging on. If you would like to log on from Zoom, just send me a private message and I'll try to catch it and send you the Zoom information. I know it's a little easier to catch it on Zoom, definitely depending on what type of device you're using. But anyway, if you're watching on Facebook, let me pull up the video. If you're watching on Facebook and you have any questions or any comments, please go ahead and comment on the video. And right now we are looking for a market to analyze this week. So I'm going to ask Dwayne if he's got a market in mind. Well, I can test out my speaker too. There we
Cleveland?
Go.
How about Cleveland, Ohio?
Okay. Yep. Cleveland. It's funny because I have been looking at Cleveland quite a bit. And I think last week we might have had some folks on from Cleveland, but I've been looking at Cleveland quite a bit. I was actually looking at Cleveland today, and there is a lot of opportunity in the Cleveland market. But it's an interesting market. I haven't been to, let's see. All right, I haven't been to Cleveland. I actually have a lot of family in Cleveland, but I haven't really spent a lot of time in Cleveland over the last decade, and really more than that, probably the last 20 years. I think I've only been there a handful of times, so I haven't actually been on the ground and haven't really traversed the city to get a feel for it and to get a feel for where at. So it's hard for me to really tell. You know, outside of looking at the information, it's kind of hard to tell, to get a real feel for where the city is going. But there is a lot of opportunity in Cleveland. All right. Let me stop checking. I was trying to keep up with my messages. It's going to prove a little difficult. All right. Let's see. Okay. All right. So let's check out Cleveland. Actually, Dwayne, are you in Cleveland, or did you you have any familiarity with the Cleveland market?
I'm actually from. Hi, how are you? So I'm actually from Long Island, New York. New to real estate investing and just reading information, watching podcasts and videos the past 4 weeks, 6 weeks. And come across a few sources that said that Cleveland is a market that's seen a lot of job growth and population growth and would be a good market to look at.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's great, man. I'm glad that I was able to connect with you, and just to tell you a little bit about me, man. I've been in real estate for 10 years. I've got mostly a background in residential, and then I spent the last 2 years really transitioning from focusing on residential to focusing more on the commercial space, and in particular the multifamily space, which from a technical standpoint, anything 2 to 4 units is considered residential multifamily. And then, anything 5 units or more is considered commercial. But with my residential background, I actually worked in residential and commercial, but my residential background ranges from sales and brokerage. I'm a broker in a couple states and ran a brokerage for a while, had, some agents working under me, did a lot of development and investment work and worked with a lot of developers. Did some working for one of the local governments in Cincinnati, doing some commercial real estate stuff and just a couple other things. So I got a nice, just wide range of experience in real estate, and just really decided, made a conscious decision to kind of really just focus and narrow my focus and develop a deeper expertise in the multifamily space. And it just so happened that the timing of everything was perfect, because where we are right now, and I don't know if they've been talking about this just with the information, that you've been studying, but with the pandemic, what's happening is investors, from the top to the bottom, at the top of the investor pool, you have basically insurance companies, you have pension funds, you have governments, and you have corporations, and it kind of filters down all the way to where we are now with just everyday individuals. But with the pandemic and other asset classes, and not just other asset classes, including other asset classes within real estate, are distressed, and so a lot of capital is shifting, looking for opportunity, and from all angles, when you look at investing and you look at investing in businesses, because essentially that's what buying a multifamily property is. It's basically buying an existing business or buying a business that needs some work. When you look at all the different parameters, the demand for multifamily and the consistency of that revenue is unmatched and unparalleled. So there are a lot of people shifting their capital into the multifamily space. But also at the same time, there is significant demand for housing and the country over the next, just in the next 10 years, the country has a demand of at least 5 million more units that we need to bring online across the country in order to just meet the demand of natural birth and especially to meet the demand of immigration. So there's a lot of opportunity to build a substantial portfolio in the multifamily space. So,
one question I had, if I may, is I know you look at, like, you know, where the jobs are going, you look at population growth, but how do you determine if the supply of the housing is, and obviously looking at, you know, permits, you know, there's new development that's coming, but how do you determine between the new development that's coming online with the next year, 18 months, and the current supply with the population growth, if it's enough to meet the demand, or it's going to oversaturate the market? You know, you think you see where the growth is, but you may have too many multifamily units in a market, and then you won't get the return that you expect.
Yeah, it's a couple different layers to that, because when you have new demand coming onto the market, that's Class A, is what's considered Class A. So there are various classes. There's basically Class C, Class B, and Class A. Those are the three primary designations when it comes to multifamily. Now, whenever you have new development that's Class A, when Class A comes online, that's a different market and a different resident who's looking at Class A versus Class B versus Class C. And then in this environment, you have a lot of people who are vacating Class A because they're trying to reduce their expenses. So they're moving into Class B, and Class A is being affected a little bit. Class B is kind of that perfect medium because it's the property condition is, you know, pretty up to date. The rents are more affordable, and they're not quite Class C. And Class C tends to be a lot more outdated. It may be, you know, what's considered a rougher neighborhood. So where you are as an investor, your focus isn't necessarily on the, and it depends on, you know, what size you're investing in. But if you're more focused in the C class or the B class, you're going to have a higher demand as opposed to if you were coming online with Class A. So unless you're doing new construction, the issue of supply and demand probably isn't going to affect you that much. Okay. Yeah, but there are market reports, and we'll go over some of the market reports, but there are national brokerages and regional brokerages, and depending on where you are, a place like Cleveland, they don't publish as frequently as I would like, but brokerages will, national brokerage firms and local ones, regional ones, if they're producing a lot of content, they'll publish basically market reports. And those market reports are published on usually on a quarterly basis. And then depending on the location, it may be a quarterly basis, it might be every 6 months, it might be once a year. But in that report, it's going to tell you about what the supply and demand is. It's going to tell you about what the total construction units are that are under construction right now. It'll tell you about the absorption and how long it's taken for those units to basically be absorbed by the market. And so it gives you a little bit more detail to kind of help you just analyze where the market is in terms of demand and where supply is. And then you can also look at the trends of the population trends versus the permits versus the actual units that are coming online versus the units that have come online in the last year. So you just got to kind of look at it, kind of ebb and flow. I don't know if there's a data point to look at that'll say, okay, this market is oversaturated in terms of where you are as an investor. But I'll definitely look into that and follow up. That's a great question. All right. So let's start off. Let's actually pull up. I was looking at this company earlier. All right, so what I'm gonna do, let me go ahead and hop over to the screen share. What's up, Aaron? I see you on, brother.
What's up? What's up? You know, getting it in, man. Eating dinner with the fam. Just yes, watching. Sir. You know, take in.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah, I'm neglecting my family time right now, but
You're good. While you can get it in, while you can, man.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Okay, let me know. You know that you can see everybody, that you can see my screen. I did a screen share, and this is actually I was reading this good article on LoopNet. All right. So let us pull up. All right, I gotta learn how to move this bar out the way. There we go. High floating meeting controls. Press escrow. All right. All right, cool. So you can still see my screen, right? We got a bunch of people watching on Facebook. Definitely let me know in the comments where you are checking in from. I think today we are going to look at, we're going to look at Cleveland. And when we're looking at these markets, the biggest thing is research. Especially if it's a market that you don't really know anything about or you've never been to, it's really just research and research and research and just finding out as much data points as you can find. And as an investor, whether you're investing for yourself or you're investing on behalf of other people, having a feel for where market opportunity may exist, and where market opportunity is now is something that you want to stay abreast of, because one, you want to diversify markets as you as you grow. And by diversifying markets, then you're going to have to be aware of, okay, where are some of the hotter markets? Or you may be in a market where the competition is so stiff, or the price to entry is so high that you're kind of forced to look for other markets to invest in. Now, they recommend investing, first starting off by investing either in your backyard or investing in a market that you have basically feet on the ground. You may have family, you may have some friends, you have some type of resources on the ground that can kind of help you with that process that you have to go through to familiarize yourself with the property, to manage the property, and things like that. And then there are going to be times where you just simply have to find a market where you don't particularly know anybody or you don't have feet on the ground, but there is opportunity in that market. And so the biggest thing, like I said, is just research. So of course, LoopNet is a good resource to just start looking for available properties, commercial properties. And then using something like Redfin. I like to use Redfin. You can use Redfin or Trulia. These are just going to give you the what's available on market. Now, one thing you could do to bypass a lot of, I won't say bypass, but kind of as a, I don't want to say a one-stop shop, but a good place to start to get some of your data. If, let's say, for example, you are on LoopNet and you're looking for information, when you're looking at these properties, there should be something called an offering memorandum that's included with the listing. And depending on how well that offering memorandum was put together, there's going to be a lot of information in that, what they call OM for short. There's going to be a lot of information in that OM that should give you information, not just about the property, but it should also give you some information about the immediate area. The immediate area being the immediate vicinity of like a 1 to 5 mile radius in terms of demographics, but it also should give you some highlighted information about the city in which that investment is located. And it's the commercial broker's job and responsibility, which they do to varying degrees of accuracy, as well as varying degrees of thoroughness. But it is the commercial broker's job to supply you with some amount of information to help sell this investment. And if they standardize their process, that information is going to include some basic information about the city, including major employers, development news, other properties that exist in the area, as well as what those properties may be renting for and things like that. So what I did is I hopped on here, I hopped on to LoopNet, went to Cleveland, and just selected one of the properties that was listed in Cleveland. And I'm gonna just check and see. Now, part of that data, all right, when you first pull up the property, you already start getting the data points, right? The first one, we got a property address, 1585 to 1587 Millard Drive. This is Mayland Towers. Now, just to caveat this, and I know Dwayne, I don't know what size properties you might be looking at, but on LoopNet, this is going to be 5 units and up. Now, with this 80-unit, this is an 80-unit property being offered at $6.25 million in Cleveland. Now, the offering memorandum, I got to caveat that, because if you are looking on, let's just jump over here to Redfin, and we'll do a parallel for Cleveland. Yep, it's funny because I already got Cleveland in here. I think that's from earlier, but let's do a parallel and we'll look at how listings come up on LoopNet versus how they come up on, say, a Redfin. Now, anything on Redfin that's 2 to 4 units is probably most likely not going to have any type of offering memorandum. I don't even think that you agents can attach documents to their listings on Redfin, on Trulia, and on Zillow. The only time a 2 to 4 unit is going to have an offering memorandum document with it is if that property is being offered as part of what's called a portfolio sale. And with the portfolio sale, what happens is, say someone owns 5 properties in a particular location, 7 properties, 10 properties. And in this case, let's say they're all multifamily, but they're not always going to be multifamily. But if somebody owns multiple properties, right, what our objective is and what our goal is to build our own investment portfolios. Sometimes people are selling either their entire portfolio or they're liquidating a portion of their portfolio. So when that happens, there may be properties of different sizes in there. There may be a couple duplexes in there. There may be a couple triplexes or 4 units, there may be a 10 unit in there. So whenever there's a property or a portfolio that's being sold and there's a 2 to 4 unit in there, then that 2 to 4 unit may be included in that offering memorandum, but that offering memorandum probably isn't going to speak directly to the details of that 2 to 4 unit. And what they're going to do is they're just going to kind of lump all of the numbers together and kind of give you the lump sum numbers and leave it up to you to kind of figure out how to break down the numbers from there. Hey, what's up, Wendy? I see you. Michigan in the house. All right, so here we are on LoopNet. I'm gonna sort this. I've already got this filtered to multifamily because like I said, I was on here earlier. I think I do. All right, we'll just double check. And I just happened to be looking at Cleveland earlier. So when you go on these sites like Redfin, you have to filter your search results, because if you don't, everything will come up, including single family houses, condos, and stuff like that. So we've done our search for Cleveland, and we have 150 results that have come up, and we've done our sort. So we put the filter on for multifamily. And then as you can see, it brings up a map of Cleveland, this gray line that you can see. I hope you all can see that gray line that outlines Cleveland. Basically, that's the city limits of Cleveland. And then outside of the city limits, you're going to have your surrounding counties. And then you'll have to search by county, or you'll have to search by what they call submarket in order for you to be able to search outside of the city limits. All right, so what I'll do is I'll just scroll down really quickly on the right-hand side as I scroll down. Cincinnati in the building. What's up, Marcellus? All right, so as I scroll down, you'll see there are a lot of properties in Cleveland. When you're looking at this 2 to 4 unit space, there are a lot of properties, And every location is not the same. Ohio is one of those unique places where there are a lot of 2 to 4 unit properties. If you look, if you're looking at Cleveland, if you're looking at Cincinnati, if you're looking at Columbus, Toledo, it's just one of those places where there are a lot of multifamily properties, a lot of standalone multifamily properties too, in this 2 to 4 unit space. There are other locations where you just don't have as much inventory, or you don't have as much in terms of housing type. But as I scroll down, you'll see there are a lot of them, and there are a lot of different types. There's wood frame. Wood frame is basically a house that's built entirely with wood. These are like this one, I'm pretty sure is wood frame. It's got a concrete or cinder block foundation, and then the entire building was built up with wood frame, as opposed to something that was built with brick or a brick veneer. When you're investing, you have to take into account, and I'll try not to get too off track, but when you're investing, you have to take into account the material of the property. Something that's wood frame is not going to necessarily have the same durability as something that was built with solid brick. This is a great example where you can see over time, and I'll see if this, we can pull up a bigger picture. But you'll see over time that the property becomes weathered. The siding becomes weathered. It doesn't hold up like brick does. So that's an expense that at some point you as an investor you're going to have to cover that expense if it needs repair or replacement, as opposed to brick. Something that solid brick obviously is not going to have the same wear and tear, and you're not going to have the same siding concerns as you would with something that's wood frame, as well as just the overall general durability of the property. Something built out of brick is going to stand for hundreds of years. Something that's built out of wood may collapse on you. I mean, that's an extreme situation, but let's say we're buying in Cleveland. As you're looking through these listings in Cleveland, Cleveland is a heavy value add investment opportunity, which means that these properties need a lot of work. So as I'm looking at this one, one thing that I would have to caution anyone on is, okay, well, is there any water damage, right? If we have damage to the siding, if we have outdated siding, then one of the things we definitely got to look for is water damage. And I'm going to finish with this because I want to pull back a little bit. But as I pull through, I'm going to pull up a couple pictures, and we'll probably see some signs of water damage. And that water damage is going to get to the wood. It's going to rot the wood out. So you may have substantial repair or replacement that needs to be done with the wood structure. In this case, it looks like they went in and they tore out the copper. A lot of drywall work because they did tear out the copper. And I'll leave this one with this. Whenever you're looking for water damage, you should always be looking at the ceiling of the property. Look at the ceiling of the top floor to see if I don't know how well you can see this one, but there's water damage in the corner. So when you're on the top floor, always check the ceilings for water damage, for water imprint, to see if the existing roof needs repair or replacement, or to see if there was a sign that the roof was leaking so that you can confirm that the roof was repaired or replaced. And then when you're on the bottom floor, you're looking for the same signs to see if there was any leaking plumbing that may have leaked, to make sure that leak was fixed and that the ceiling was repaired sufficiently. All right. So anyway, let's back out and get back on to LoopNet. I just wanted to kind of give you an idea that there's a difference in the listings on Redfin and LoopNet. Now let's get back over to LoopNet. Now on LoopNet, what we're looking for, hopefully on this 80 unit, we'll find out really quickly, but hopefully on this 80 unit, there's an offering memorandum that was included with the listing. So as we're scrolling down, we've got the broker's information. His name is Eric Schreibman, works for Cushman and Wakefield. Cresco Real Estate may be his individual company brand that's affiliated with Cushman, or it may be the office that's affiliated with Cushman. What's up, Ebony? What's up, Justin? Good to see you, brother. What's up, Deacon Bobby? All right, so let's see if this one has an offering memorandum. Perfect. All right, so as we're scrolling down, I'm kind of bypassing some of the information because right now we're just focused on that offering memorandum. In the link section, we got a couple links. Under attachments, we have some type of attachment. This might be the rent roll. It might be some other financial data. But what we're interested in right now, what's up, Elroy? What we're interested in right now is the offering memorandum. And so we click on offering memorandum and let's see what kind of information they give us. Okay, so it says listing unavailable. This listing is temporarily unavailable or is closed. All right, so no access to the offering memorandum on that one. Let's go back to the search results and see if we can find another one. And sometimes with the offering memorandums, sometimes they'll be listed directly on LoopNet, so you could open it immediately. Sometimes it's going to take you to the broker's website. And sometimes when it takes you to the broker's website, they're going to ask you to essentially sign a non-disclosure form. And that non-disclosure form basically is going to have some information in there about basically protecting the broker and the broker's position. And protecting the data that's in that offering memorandum. And just has a couple things. There are a lot of different ones. They have different language in them. But don't be afraid to sign the disclosure form because you're going to need that offering memorandum anyway. All right, let's see. 5 units, 8 units, 6 units, 6 units, 11 units, 11 units. All right, I'm trying to pick one that I know for sure. Hopefully you'll have an operating memorandum. If not, we'll go to some other data sources and check those out. Okay, let's try this one. This is a 22 unit. I think I looked at that one before. Let's try this one, 36 unit. Crandall Park Apartments. And another thing too, with LoopNet, when you're working in a commercial space, even a residential space, in the residential space, you're probably gonna be working with a realtor. If you're not working with a realtor and you're doing everything on your own, then you're gonna have to reach out to the agent who may or may not be a broker. The same with LoopNet, some of these people aren't particularly brokers, they're just agents. But nonetheless, you should be building your database, your contact database of brokers and agents in the market or markets that you are focused on. Because one of the things, especially in the commercial space, everything that's available is not listed online. It's totally different from residential real estate. Both residential and commercial have off-market channels and they have on-market channels. By off-market, if you aren't familiar with that term, it basically means a property that is not listed on what's called the MLS or the multiple listing service. On the commercial side, it's the same way. You have off-market channels, on-market channels. If it's on-market, then it's listed with the agent, it's listed with the broker, and it's listed on some type of listing service. If it's off-market, it may not be listed with an agent. It may be direct to seller, or it may be with a third party like a wholesaler. Either way, you want to be building that contact list and that database because, especially on the commercial side, a lot of brokers and agents don't publish or publicize their available listings, and they're marketing and selling these properties to their short lists or their list of investors rather than listing it on a site like LoopNet, as opposed to residential. When an agent is working with a seller, 99 times out of 100, they're signing a listing agreement. And in that listing agreement, the seller is authorizing that agent to list that property on the MLS. And 99% of the time, that agent is going to list that property on the MLS. So when you're looking at properties on Redfin, you're looking at properties on Trulia and Zillow, those are your MLS properties that are syndicated directly from the agent MLS website for that locality. So when you look on those sites, you're going to see the vast majority of available listings that are on market. All right. Which also means unless you're affiliated or connected to some third parties like a wholesaler, you're most likely not going to you're not going to see those off-market transactions, but you're still going to see a substantial amount of available properties. And the commercial space is not like that. We can hop on LoopNet right now and look at different properties or different markets. And some markets, they may say, hey, there are no multifamily properties available for sale right now. And you're like, hey, how is that even possible? Well, it's because the agents, the brokers in commercial, their protocol is not to list those properties in the same way residential agents list properties. So you want to develop those contact lists, and then you want to be able to develop and build relationships with these agents so that you can have access to their listserv. A lot of agents basically have mailing lists. They'll shop their deals, and especially the commercial, they'll shop their deals to their short list of people, and then they'll shop it to their larger list, and then they'll shop it on, say, LoopNet or something like that. So definitely make sure you're collecting names, addresses, and phone numbers. All right, so we were lucky enough to get a offering memorandum. I'm going to zoom in a little bit. This one is for a property in Cleveland. This is called Crandall Apartments in Cleveland. And at the top corner, we see the broker is Passoff Real Estate Group, commercial brokerage. We have the location of the property. This is 2830 to 2836 East 100th Street, zip code 44120, latitude, longitude. It gives us that data. Then as we scroll down, it gives us contact information. It gives us the listing broker. Now, what we wanted to look at is what kind of information is this offering memorandum going to give us about the Cleveland market and about the immediate area surrounding this property. Now, I can tell you already that this offering memorandum is only 7 pages, so it's not going to have a ton of information. Offering memorandums, usually a really good one is usually going to be anywhere between like 15 to 30 pages. So when you're at 7, you're getting the bare amount of information. So let's see what kind of information they give us. All right, we got a confidential disclaimer. We have a snapshot of the properties. This is it consists of 2 buildings. New Shaker Square development. All right, perfect. So here we have some development news, all right, about this particular property. It tells us about Crandall Apartments. It's in the historic Shaker Square district. It's a 4-minute walk to the RTA bus line. So that's, and technically it's they're not even supposed to say this is a violation of fair housing rules. You're not supposed to say walk because everybody can't walk, but it's a 4-minute, says 4-minute walk. I'll just say 4-minute commute to the RTA bus line. That's good. So, you know, if there is demand from the resident base for transportation, you have the RTA bus line. It gives us a breakdown of how many units. There are 22 1-bedroom, 1-bath units. It tells us about covered parking with revenue. When they say covered parking with revenue, and I'm assuming this is existing, basically they have parking spots that they're charging residents for. It may not be all residents. It may be a few residents who are paying to park right in front of the building. And just a side note, when you're looking at these properties, and this could be in the 2 to 4 unit space as well, especially if you're in a market where parking is at a high demand, you can charge an additional fee for the parking. And by charging that additional fee, you also increase the total revenue of that property. So here we have covered parking with revenue, washer dryer revenue, which basically means coin operated laundry, security cameras, all that type of stuff. But I'm assuming because they don't give us any text detail, they just give us images that we're close to or in proximity. Okay, perfect. Here we are. So this is the new Shaker Square redevelopment. Now, I have no idea what that is. We'll Google that next. But if you can see this red line here, this red line is on East 130th Street, which is the same street that Crandall Apartments is on. I'm not sure how far of a distance that is, but it also looks like we're adjacent to the new Van Aken district. So when we're looking at the overarching statistics, we're looking for job growth. We're looking for population growth. Now that job growth and that population growth, that's going to depend on a couple factors. If that's something that's really important to you. If you're a local investor and you're investing in your backyard, a lot of times you're not even really paying attention to the population growth and the job growth because you live there and you're investing in your community, and you may be investing more for cash flow as opposed to cash flow and appreciation. When we're talking about the job growth and we're talking about the population growth, we're kind of looking at that from a standpoint of, is there going to be adequate appreciation, and can we expect there to be, you know, some type of demand for apartments when we go to sell them? So it's a little more geared towards the appreciation aspect, not so much the cash flow aspect. All right, so let's look at now outside of the job growth and the population, you're also looking to see, okay, what's going on in the neighborhood? Is the neighborhood growing? Is there, you know, reinvestment in the neighborhood, or is the neighborhood dying and our businesses going out of business? Because that's going to affect the demand for whether or not your unit is appealing to rent. Is it near amenities? Is it in an area where people want to move in terms of in the location in the city? Because if it's somewhere that's in high demand or somewhere that is attracting a lot of people, then it makes it easier for you to be able to, one, fill your units, right? And then two, to be able to get market rate for those units. Because a lot of times, especially when we're talking about smaller investors in the 2 to 4 unit space, and I see this all the time. I look at properties and deals all the time. Owners are not charging market rent for their units, and they're not keeping up with market rent. And so somebody might be renting at a particular location, and the rent hasn't changed in 5 years or 7 years or 10 years, which just off of the strength of inflation, if the rent isn't changing, then you as the owner, you're losing money rather than just maintaining the status quo, because $450 today is not the same as $450 tomorrow, just off of the strength of inflation and the cost of living and things going up. So if you aren't maintaining the rental rate at your property, then you aren't keeping up with the incomes and the expenses as well as you could have, as well as just getting what the unit actually demands. So being in these areas where the market rent is on a steady incline, is keeping up with inflation, or it's ahead of inflation, allows you to be able to increase your rents year to year, allows you to stay with expenses because you got other expenses that are still going up. Your property taxes are probably going up, right? If you've got trash service, your trash service is probably going up. So it's not always just, can I increase the rents to increase the rents? It's, hey, there are other expenses that are going up with the ownership of this property as well. And I need to keep up with the ownership and the maintenance of this property. But anyway, moving on. So let's check out and see what is this new Shaker Square development. And again, this is us doing our market research. New Shaker Square development, Cleveland. And by pulling this up, this is going to pull up an entirely new set of information because it's going to tell us about the project itself. It's going to tell us, it may have and probably is going to have some type of information on how they expect that project to impact the immediate area, whether that's economically, whether that's by population. It'll give us an idea of how much money was invested. All right, so this looks like this is the Neighborhood Development Corporation, and not particularly about a specific project. So I'm just going to scan through here and see what development news they have. Let's see. Neighborhood. All right, we'll check out revitalization and restoration. It's 7:46 already. Okay. All right. So under the revitalization and restoration, they have a lot of good information about reinvestment that's going on in this particular community where this property is located. So let's see, I'll summarize these. In 2016, the Cleveland Planning Commission reviewed conceptual designs for a new school that is to be built. The school is going to be a 400 student, 90,000 square foot facility. The school was made possible in special support of Cleveland residents who passed an issue in 2014. That was dated in 2016. So I don't know if Sunbeam School has been constructed and erected, but reinvestment. We've got a blight reduction at East 130th Street in Drexmoor. I believe our property we're looking at is on East 130th Street. So that's actually a good sign. We've got some blight reduction. Let's see, at Shaker Square, two vandalized buildings have been demolished after years of neglect. Thanks to the orchestrated efforts of concerned residents, the Shaker Square Area Development Corporation and some other organizations. They've got monthly meetings at the Development Corporation that will continue with stakeholders to improve security and redevelopment in the Shaker Square area. We've got Larchmere Boulevard Streetscape and Landscaping. This was a federal transportation enhancement grant of $587,000 for streetscape and landscaping improvements in the Larchmere Boulevard Retail District. Cleveland Housing Network, partnering with the Development Corporation, with a citywide organization for the provision of renovated and newly constructed affordable housing. And then we have an uptown traffic plan, which is, a coalition. The Uptown Traffic Committee is a coalition of major stakeholders advocating for a set of five city approved roadway modifications for improving traffic flow and safety in a certain corridor. So again, that chain of information. All right, let's go back to the offering memorandum. We've also got adjacent to the new Van Dyke district. What's up, JR? Cincinnati in the building. All right, so I want to scroll down a little bit to give you a little more idea of some of the other data that's going to be inside this offering memorandum. A lot of times what you'll see is they're going to outline all of the different retail establishments that are in the area, all the different major service providers like banking. And what they're trying to do is they're trying to show you that in the immediate vicinity, you've got grocery stores, you've got banks, you've got fast food restaurants, you may have a Walmart, you may have a Target. All of these different things are drivers of people, people coming and people going. So when you have a high traffic area, one, it's going to attract people who may not have transportation. They want to live next to a grocery store. They want to live close to certain amenities. But then it also shows you that there are other people who are going to come from outside of the community who are going to service these businesses. And they may want to live in the area and may be looking for a particular place to stay. So it just kind of covers the demand for the area, the different businesses that are invested in the area, as well as just what's servicing the particular area. So as you can see, they, and what they'll do is they'll outline a particular property or outline your property. They'll show you where your property is as it relates to various, the various retail and service providers in the immediate area. So we'll scroll down again. And when you're looking at this, you're just using, you know, basic, basic logic when you're looking at some of this stuff. If this is a desert and there's absolutely nothing there, then, you know, that's, that can tell you a couple of things. It might be difficult for you to find, you know, people to rent that space, unless it's more like of a rural area and people are accustomed to driving, you know, to go here and there. But this is a urban city. This is Cleveland. So we're looking for some foot traffic as well as people being able to drive. All right, so on this particular page, this looks like, okay, and on this page, and you don't see this one a lot, this is an interesting data point. They're showing you all of these different dots on this page are different locations for data, daycare centers. So they're just kind of showing you that, hey, there are a lot of places, you know, obviously where people can take their children, which must be, you know, might be more important. I don't know. Like I said, usually you don't really see, you don't see that page as a separate standalone. So I'm not sure why they, you know, why they wanted to highlight that, but nonetheless, showing you that there are available daycare centers. If that area is more geared towards, I don't know. That's an interesting one. All right, let's see. RTA transit map. Here's a transit map. Is showing you where your property is. If you remember, it said before that the property was within about 4 minutes of a typical walking commute from the RTA station. It looks like it's actually close to several, walking distance or commuting distance to several locations. You got Drexmoor, you got Shaker Square, you got Coventry, you got Shaker Boulevard, Buckeye Road, South Woodland. So you got a lot of options for this RTA, which is good. We're on the Quincy and Buckeye bus route, University Circle, Rapid Station, Blue Line. You're on a blue and green lines, and the yellow is a 24/7 service line. All right, so that's the end of this operating memorandum. There are a few photos. So again, I told you, you know, at seven pages, it's extremely short. So just to point out a couple things that's missing, it's not giving you any demographic detail in terms of financials. It's not, well, demographics in terms of within a 1 mile radius, this is the population, this is the average income, household income, that type of deal. And more importantly, it's not giving you any financials. Without having the financials, you can't do any analysis on this particular property. So I'm gonna just go back to the listing real quick. Sometimes on the listing, they'll put the financial information. There's no financial information on the listing page. So you would have to reach out to the broker to request the financial information. Now, since it's 7:54, I wanna finish with, I just wanna keep these under an hour. So what I'm gonna do is pull up Cleveland Market Report, Multifamily Market Report. So we can see what the market data is telling us. All right, so here's a recent one. This one is from winter 2020. No, that's dated February 3rd of 2020. So that's really 2019 data. Let's see, Colliers, I think this is Q3 of 2020. Q4 hasn't come out. So let's check out this one. This is from Colliers International. And it looks like this is gonna be Q3 2020 data, which means it probably came out in October, November. All right, let's see. So it actually looks like this isn't even a market report. Let's see. allow cookies. Yeah, it doesn't look like this one is a market report, but it does have some market information about Cleveland. That's retail. Let's see. Q3 retail Cleveland report. We want multifamily. Let's see, industrial. Make sure I didn't miss it. All right, let's view more. Office. Q2. I don't see Q3 for multifamily. All right, so let's just pull up the Q2 report. It's not right now, it's not important, you know, if it's Q2 or Q3. Right now, what we're doing is we're just really getting an idea of what's going on in the market and how to look for the information we need and then how to interpret the information that we're looking at. Okay, so download report. This looks like it was dated August 28th, 2020. And they have a quick overview. What's up, Roderick? Man, we got to catch up, brother. All right, let's pull this report up. Yeah, we are on the tail end, just finishing up with just doing a small analysis of Cleveland, just kind of going over some of the data points, looking at the different opportunities that might exist. Now I got a caveat this. When you're looking at these market reports from these national brokerages, usually it's only going to be commercial data. The only way you're going to get residential data is if you reach out to or have a relationship with a residential agent and you ask that residential agent to pull sales data for the residential multifamily sales over whatever course of time, because for whatever reason, a lot of residential agents don't specialize. And when they don't specialize, unless you can find a multifamily specialist that's doing residential and commercial, but even then, a lot of times they're not publishing market reports. So when we're looking at these market reports, we kind of got to look at them with a grain of salt if we're not focused on five or more units. Like if you're in a 2 to 4 unit space, it's going to give you a lot of good information about the bigger and broader market in your area. But that information is not particularly tailored to the 2 to 4 unit space. So you have to keep that in consideration, but nonetheless, it's still going to give you a lot of good information. So in this market report, this one again was for Q2. I think it was dated August. It was August 28th. It's showing that the U.S. sales volume for multifamily markets was at $52.2 billion, down 16.2%. $5 billion as far as Midwest sales volume, which was down 23%. And then $1.1 billion for Ohio, which looks like it was up 6.5%. Again, sales data for the national market, the Midwest market, and the local market. Now, because this is from Q2, obviously Q2 was right in the midst of really everybody trying to figure out, all right, what's going on with COVID? And yes, sales were down, but the market was still very robust. There's still a lot of transactions happening, still a lot of people going in and buying. And also from a multifamily standpoint, a lot of people were still paying their rent. So this data is going to be a little skewed. It definitely will be better when we can get that Q4 data. As a matter of fact, while I'm talking about it, On Thursday, I'm going to be doing a 2021 market outlook to talk about some of the 2019 data and to talk about what's going on or what we can expect from 2021. That's going to be Thursday at 7 p.m. here on Facebook as well as Zoom. I'll publish that information certainly. And then also a quick plug on Tuesday, tomorrow, we're going to be doing an interview with a short-term rental investor to talk about short-term rentals. And then on Wednesday, we have a multifamily meetup, which is a monthly meetup that will is our first meeting on Wednesday, and we'll be doing that every second Wednesday of the month at 7 p.m. as well. All right, so let me finish with this. It's 8 o'clock. Just want to highlight a couple things on this market report. Again, every market report you look at from a broker is going to be totally different. On this one, they're talking about apartment demand follow suit with COVID hitting as demand plunged 77% of the seasonal average, recording only 33,966 units, according to the data from RealPage. RealPage is a data source. Moving on down, it gives you a national highlight, and then it gives you a Cleveland, well, Ohio highlight. And then based on Ohio, it gives you some data particular to the individual markets in Cleveland. So let's focus on this really quickly. I'll zoom in a little bit so you can see that better. All right, so Ohio apartment market data Q2 2020. It's showing us by metro area. We have Cincinnati, we got Cleveland, we got Columbus, we got Dayton, and we have Akron. It tells us the inventory, the number of units. It tells us how many units are vacant or were vacant at this particular time. It tells us what the annual demand is in terms of new units. It tells us what our occupancy rate is. That occupancy rate at 96.3%. I don't know, Dwayne, if you're still on, but that 96.3 is extremely good. It means statistically that you've got less than a 5% vacancy amount, which that 5%, you're going to account for that vacancy anyway, in terms of just running your numbers and accounting for vacancy, whether you have vacant units or not. Our annual new supply of units is 845 units. So showing you kind of what we had talked about initially, our annual demand for new units in Cleveland is showing 1,320. It's showing the new units that came on to the market was 845. So just off of the strength, we're behind in terms of Cleveland is behind in terms of whether it's meeting its annual demand, but there are 2,427 units under construction, which we don't know when all of those units are going to come online. So right now there is still increased demand. Well, as a Q2, there is a increased demand for units to come online. And then basically based on how many units are under construction, you've got yet less than a 2-year supply of available units that'll be coming online of new units. And then it gives us our average monthly rent and our average rent per square foot. So again, when you're looking at these market reports, they're gonna give you hey, what's up, Aurelia? I'm sorry, I messed your name up, Aurelia. We're finishing up, but thanks for logging on. So when you're looking at these market reports, again, they're going to give you a lot of information. They're going to tell you about where the market was in the previous quarter. They may give you some insight into where the market is headed. And then finally, it's going to give you some highlights on what's happening in the market in terms of if there's been job growth. They may highlight some of the job growth. They may highlight some of the population growth, and they may highlight some of the companies that are coming in or some of the developments that are happening. All right. So. All right. I'm sorry. Whoever just connected by iPhone. Yep, we'll be here every week, so don't worry about it. Also, the video will be posted so you can watch, you know, at your leisure. But just finishing up. So Dwayne, just going back to what you had asked me earlier about the supply and demand. So when you're looking at the market report, it tells you what the annual demand is, or some market reports will tell you what the annual demand is. And then it's going to tell you how many are under construction and then what the new supply is. But again, if you aren't doing brand new construction, if you are doing ground up development, or you're bringing a unit online that was offline, and you're talking about 2 units, you're talking about 4 units, you're talking about 6 units, as you can see, that absorption period, one, you're going to be able to bring you know, two units online, unless it's new construction. Even in new construction, you're most likely going to be able to bring your new units online a lot quicker than the complexes that are coming on that are, you know, 40 units, 50 units, 100 units, 150 units. So again, you're not really going to be meshed into that supply and demand ratio too much, as opposed to a bigger investor who's looking to make a decision as to whether or not they're going to build, you know, 200 units or 300 units or something like that. All right. So 805. Any questions? If you're on Facebook, if you got any questions, put them in the comments. If you're logged on Zoom, let me know if you got any questions.
Hey,
and,
yo.
Yes, sir.
So, you know, doing this whole market analysis and everything, where would you go, or what would usually be the first step as far as trying to close on a deal per se, you know, going through an agent or just wholesale? Or what would you recommend as far as, you know, doing a multifamily deal?
Great question. So, all right. So the first step, and it's very similar to buying a house in terms of figuring out how you're going to pay for it. Depending on the size of the property, that's going to come with different implications. But one is figuring out, okay, how am I going to pay for it? Once you got that figured out, whether that's going to be a group investment with a group of investors, whether it's going to be a private lender who's giving you a mortgage, or whether it's a mortgage lender who's going to be financing it, whatever that makeup looks like. So that's the first hurdle, is figuring out, okay, what price point am I going in at? Am I going in by myself, or am I going in with a group? Because that changes the dynamics. Once you have that figured out and you know what your price point is, and what size property you're looking for, and you got an idea of how you're going to pay for it and how you're going to finance it, which essentially is figuring out your investment criteria. And then as part of that criteria, how you're going to fund it. And then from there, you have a couple different options. You have the option of working with a broker. You have an option of working with the agent, or you have the option of working with a wholesaler and going through the off-market channels. Depending on what your skill set is and what your experience is with real estate, you may be more comfortable with one route or another, or depending on what your how you're going to fund the transaction, it's going to be more beneficial, or you may more be more advantageous for you to go one route as opposed to another. So to give you further context on that, let's say you have all of your funding lined up, and you're going to use a kind of a quicker funding source for a short-term financing situation. Let's say you're going to buy a duplex and you got some work to do, so you're going to use a very short-term loan to go in. That loan can close in a very quick amount of time with, you know, very little issues in terms of underwriting a deal. And you use that funding source can close in 15 to 30 days, right? With that type of financing, you can go to a wholesaler and close on that property in the time frame that wholesaler is looking to close on that property, as opposed to, let's say you're going to a more traditional bank and getting a more traditional funding or financing source, and that financing source is going to take 30 to 45 days, or 45 days to 60 days. Then you're not going to have the same competitive conversation or even leverage with a wholesaler, because a wholesaler is looking at moving units quickly. Now, if you're using a more traditional source, and let's say you don't have as much experience dealing in an off-market transaction field, because when you're dealing in that off-market transaction field, you don't have representation. You're representing yourself. So if you aren't adept and don't know enough in terms of what you're looking for and how to protect yourself, then you're going to want to have representation. So you're going to want to work with the agent. You're going to want to work with the broker, because that broker and that agent is there. Their job is to advise you through that transaction to make sure that you are following, you know, the proper steps to protect yourself and to make a good investment decision, or at least they're bringing to the forefront the different questions and the different things that you need to be worried about to make sure that you're making a good well, again, making a good investment, but that the transaction, that you're protected in that transaction and that your interests are looked out for. When you're working with the wholesaler, you're working directly with that wholesaler, and typically, and you don't have that representation, you don't have anybody looking out for you. So those are just some of the, you know, the considerations. So it's not necessarily a black and white question. It depends on a number of factors.
Okay. Yeah. That pretty much answers my question. I get what you're saying though, from, you know, a real estate perspective, whether finding a deal you want to deal with real estate agent or a wholesaler. Mm-hmm. I think my first deal, I probably want to deal with a wholesaler and just get some legal representation, make sure the paperwork and the contract is right. Mm-hmm. But when you actually, you know, dealing with a multifamily, and like we were looking up on, like you were looking up in the market, and say you find out that a building is pretty much owned by a development corporation, mm-hmm. how would you go about acquiring that property from them, maybe? Or would they be a hard to sell or easy to sell, or it's really not to tell? It just depends on a relationship developed.
Well, it's going to depend. Some development companies, well, they have these, basically, they set up, local governments will set up different entities, especially if it's one where, like, let's say they have a lot of vacant property and a lot of vacant land. The government may set up a, like, a development authority, where it's this quasi-private/quasi government entity that is designed to be able to hold these properties and then to be able to process them and to sell them or develop them, sell them to private investors or develop them themselves. So usually they're going to have on their website either contact information, and I'll give you a quick example, especially because you're in Cincinnati. This will be an easy one. But they're going to have some type of contact information, or they're going to have some type of property listing built on their website where they're listing all of their property available for sale. And then on their website, they're going to have some type of process outlined where they give the information on how you can purchase a property of, I don't know if that's their website, how you can, CDC. They're going to have the information published on their website of how you can.
3CDC.
Yeah. So 3CDC is a great example of that. If you go to 3CDC's website, they have information on the website where, as a private investor, private developer, they do have opportunities that they sell to private investors. So usually there's going to be some type of communication channel or information provided where you can find out how to purchase that property from that development authority.
Okay. Yeah, it's definitely something to look into, man. And I can see myself right now transitioning into that. You know, I know I'm going to take off with this first venture and endeavor I'm into, but it'll just be my choice as far as, you know, doing a multifamily. But hey, man, like I said, I'm rocking with you, bro.
So, yeah, I appreciate you.
There, bro. When the time is there, bro, don't even worry about the capital, man. It's just, give me the word, and we'll make everything else up.
I appreciate you, man. That's what it's all about, man. We you know, building a community that you know, people are focused on, you know, growth and trying to you know, accumulate wealth and achieve financial freedom. And hopefully, you know, we can do it together. We can do it individually, you know. But either way, we are, you know, here to support everybody and hopefully accomplish our goals collectively. All right. So real quick, 3CDC. All right. I was trying to find. All right. So on their website, they have somewhere on here. I just can't find it right now. But they have somewhere on here where you can go and you can look at their their properties. And then sometimes too, these organizations will have some type of funding mechanism where they will provide some type of grant money or some type of funding, some type of loan, some type of partnership structure, something like that, where they will help you get the deal done. Now, the only caveat with these development authorities and these nonprofits and stuff, typically the properties that they have available, right? Like I wouldn't necessarily recommend going through, it depends on where you're at. Cause some places like Detroit, you know, Detroit has a lot of properties that you can buy for really cheap from the land bank. But sometimes the properties need so much work that the economies of scale in terms of the return on investment may not work, or you need such a substantial mix of grants and funding and tax credits and things like that, it becomes more of a specialized investment strategy that you may not be geared towards. And because when I say geared towards, typically there are companies who essentially kind of build their expertise around doing some of these more complicated transactions. And so that may not necessarily be the best source for you to get deals, even though they may have deals available. Now that just depends on where you're, you know, where you're located, what the deal looks like and what the return numbers and everything looks like. But that's just something to consider. And sometimes those properties might be in like a historic district. And when you have that historic district, that adds a whole new layer of complexity, because you now have historic rules and regulations and groups and organizations that you now have to work through and get approval for your development project or your investment project, with that, which then increases the risk level, the complexity of the deal, the cost of the development and stuff like that. So just a lot of, you know, just some things to some extra things to consider. But nonetheless, man, it is 8:16. If y'all don't have any more questions, I'll go ahead and wrap up this week's video. Again, this will be posted on Facebook, so you can rewatch it if you want to. We'll be on next Monday to look at another market. We may circle back on Cleveland and look at some of the nitty gritty. We may look at another market, but nonetheless, the goal is every week we're looking at a different market. We're looking at the different nuances of analyzing these markets, because only through practice and repetition are we able to get better. And then also it gives us an opportunity to see where opportunity exists in the current investment landscape. So I definitely appreciate you all for logging on. It was good talking with you all and being able to share and everything. And you can feel free to contact me, you know, through Facebook. All of my information is on there, or through my website or whatever. All right,
Kev, for sure, man. Enjoy the fam, man. Pleasure speaking with you. Appreciate the knowledge that you had. Thankful, you know, and appreciative of you, bro.
All right. Thank you, Kevin. I'll see you next week.
Okay. All right. Thanks for logging on. Appreciate y'all. All right. Take care. Bye.